Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Beyond Sports. It is Hannah Stanley with you today, as I am every week. And you know, if you have listened to me at all in the past several months or years even, that I really prioritize talking about men's health merely because of the audience of the station that you are listening on. And today is no different. I am joined today by Dr. Laganosky. He is based in Philadelphia, a urologist, and he is with I'm going to have him tell you, but I believe it is the Solaris National Health Group. So Dr. Laganosky, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much for having me here, Hannah, and really just a pleasure to be able to talk with you about this important topic today. As Hannah introduced, I'm Dean Laganosky, a urologist in the Philadelphia area. I'm part of MidLantic Urology, which is a group within the Solaris National Health Network, a larger group of urologists throughout the nation. My focus and specialty is really minimally invasive surgeries and treatments for urinary oncology, as well as complex voiding dysfunction.
That is a whole bunch, but we've got 30 minutes and we're going to get through this. And I talk about this pretty much quarterly because it is something that we know men don't take as much care of their health as, and that's a stereotype, but it is based in actual fact. Men don't go to the doctor as often as they likely should as a whole. And then there are also risks that are easier to find out about, right? With simple blood tests. So let's talk about that. Let's start with prostate cancer, because that's the big one, and how it is initially detected or screened for.
Yeah, absolutely. And so to your point, I think one of the underlying pieces to really talk about here is the importance of getting screened and tested. Prostate cancer, by all the data, is one of the most common types of cancer that affects men. 183,000 men are diagnosed with new cases of prostate cancer every year in the U.S., and over 30,000 men die of prostate cancer in the U.S. each year. Issue with prostate cancer is that many times it grows very silently in the background. So there may not be symptoms that you are experiencing, even though this process could be going on. So it's really important to focus on screening, meeting with a healthcare professional, and then making sure that we are giving you the information so we can help to make informed decisions about risks and ways that we can help you.
All right. So when you discuss screening, so we're going to encourage everybody to go in and get a yearly physical. At what age does screening for prostate cancer begin?
Right. So it's a little bit different for everyone. And one of the big focuses that we've made in our urologic community over the last several decades is to really figure out when is the appropriate time for some people to get screened versus others. It's very tailored and personalized to you. So individuals of average risk, meaning they don't have family members or first degree relatives with a history of prostate cancer, they do not have other risk factors like age or African American descent, they would normally get screened around the age of 50 to 55. Individuals with elevated risk, meaning any of those risk factors I just talked about, it may be reasonable to start screening these individuals as early as the age of 40.
All right. So you said a keyword that I wanted to make sure we focused on, because it is February, it is Black History Month. And I've learned this through my interviews about this topic. Why do African Americans have a higher rate and an earlier onset potentially of prostate cancer?
Right. So very good question. And some of this data is still ongoing and some of this research into this topic. But we do know that African-American males are statistically more likely to have prostate cancer, 1.7 times the national average from that standpoint, and two times as likely to die of prostate cancer as well. So It may have to do with the genetics from this standpoint, as many of our common cancers are being found to be related to. However, it's really important that we identify this and help to structure screening at the appropriate time frame for these individuals who may be at higher risk.
Is it an earlier onset for that that demographic as well?
Correct. So it could be an earlier onset, as well as just a more likelihood of having a higher or more aggressive disease pattern that may require treatment at an earlier age. And the goal here is prostate cancer tends to be a very treatable type of cancer, but the goal will be to try to identify things early and make sure that we have a lot of different options that are all very good for giving you a cure, as opposed to waiting until much later on in the disease process when things become a much harder process to treat.
Yeah, I've been doing this show for many years, and an oncologist a long time ago said stage one cancers are curable. So the goal is to find everything in stage one. But to find these things in stage one, people, we have to get you to a doctor and have you, listener, understand that having these yearly tests, or if there are things that are going on, be it your own risk factors, or if there is something that's making you curious or concerned, then you go to a doctor immediately. Because the sooner you catch things, the more options you have. So that said, what are our options when someone presents and has their screening done? Well, let's talk about the screening. What is the screening involved? Is this very invasive?
No, typically not. I mean, the initial screening test, as you alluded to earlier, is a simple blood test called prostate-specific antigen, or PSA. It's done on a single blood draw, and it can give us a lot of information in terms of a starting point, figuring out somebody's risk. There's two benefits to doing that type of testing. One, if you have a normal test or a normal trend over time, we can give you the reassurance that there is likely nothing more ominous going on in the background. And we'll come up and work with a strategy and work with you on the types of timeframes that we would screen those numbers. The second piece is, if we do find something irregular, we have a lot of new research that's come about in the last decade where we can really give you a lot more confidence in terms of, is there something that we need to pursue further, and how we can tell what's going on so we can make informed decisions together.
All right. So this is a simple blood test. It can probably be done, what, in conjunction with the CBC, right? Which is a complete blood panel. And so really can be done yearly at your typical normal physical. So honestly, there's no excuse. This is something that should be done. Men, go to a doctor. That's all I'm saying. Okay, so now we fast forward, Dr. Laganosky, from MidLantic Urology. When someone is presenting with a possible cancer, you know, they have some irregularities in their testing, where do we go from there?
Right. So if we do detect something irregular, there are options for trying to get more information. So PSA itself is prostate specific, but not cancer specific. So there could be some other things that cause your number to be a little bit higher than usual. But some of the other tests that we have, urinary tests, additional blood tests, sometimes an imaging study like an MRI can give us a lot of confidence in a very non-invasive fashion that this is not something that could be related to a cancer or require additional treatment. There are ways that we can take directed samples of the tissue of the prostate gland, very small needle punctures to do this, and very minimally invasive from that fashion, and can give us all the information we need to really know what's going on.
Okay, so when we get through all of these, I know men are very nervous about the rectal exam, of course. Is that something that still occurs?
Right. So digital rectal examination is one piece to how we would find out if there is something abnormal within the prostate gland. Everybody has this stigma attached to what a digital rectal examination may be like. It's very quick and straightforward. And it's not the only piece of the puzzle that we use to really kind of get an idea of what's best going on here. As you said, the PSA is kind of the initial blood test. The exam is very quick, on the order of 1 to 2 seconds, and can give us a lot of information to help to guide you along the way.
All right. And can avoid, like we've mentioned, I'm in a soapbox pretty much this entire episode. So, but as we've mentioned, is being ahead of this, if it is something that is ominous, that is cancer, it is the sooner you are diagnosed, the more options you have, the less invasive things can be. What are some of the treatment options? I know science is constantly advancing, research is advancing daily. What are ways that these things are being treated currently and soon to be in the future?
Right. Perfect. And just to your last point too, I mean, just because we don't know that something is going on or you haven't chosen to go to a doctor doesn't mean that something is not potentially happening in the background. So that's the benefit of really going and getting some objective information here. In terms of what those treatments may look like, we have very effective treatments for prostate cancer, ones that can be curative, particularly if we detect this disease early. So get screened. Those treatments are most commonly either a radiation therapy for the prostate gland or a surgery that's typically done with small incisions, a robotic approach. So we've made a lot of advancements in the way that we treat prostate cancer to try to give the maximal benefit and cure rate while minimizing a lot of the historic side effects of treatment. And then there are a portion of patients who may not require any type of treatment for their prostate cancer. So we really have focused on trying to figure out patients who have a cancer that we say needs a treatment or is clinically significant, would cause them a problem, versus those that may not require any treatment and can be watched over time to make sure that they stay stable.
All right. I want to dial back a few minutes ago in the way back machine. We were discussing African-Americans and how their rate of prostate cancer, both diagnosis and death because of or due to, is much, much higher than Caucasian men. Are the types of prostate cancer they tend to have more aggressive, or is it still consistent and there's other factors included?
The likely answer to that is a combination of both. We do know that African Americans may be more likely to have aggressive prostate cancer, but there are also some other factors in terms of screening and access to, healthcare providers and other provisions that may also be at play here. So really the important thing here is that, you know, many of us healthcare providers, I mean, we see our role to really help you to live the healthiest life possible, to give you the information to work with you in a personalized fashion, to try to come up with what could be affecting you and how we can best help you with that. And it's really important if there's anything that you're nervous about or you're one of these higher risk individuals to have that initial meeting. And it can really, I think, help to put anxiety and stress related to that encounter at ease, give you a lot of information to figure out how we can best move things forward.
Okay. So when the PSA number is drawn, like through the blood work, it's established, is there a level that we don't want to be above, or how exactly does that ranking system work?
Yeah, very good question. So there is a lab value where anything above 4.0 for your test is flagged as abnormal. The reality, though, is that PSA normal values can be different for everyone. And so it does require a skilled interpretation. And really the context of when we get that blood test and how we're looking at it is something that is best to work with your health professional on. But just because you have a high value doesn't necessarily mean you have cancer. We should really be doing the testing to know if you do and if you would require a treatment for that.
Okay, so if you do have a high level, then you would go through the next steps, or are there other reasons that could cause that PSA to be elevated?
Yeah, very good question. So there are plenty of other reasons why PSA could be elevated, including just having a normal enlargement of your prostate gland that occurs for most men as we age, sometimes inflammation or infections, or sometimes activities like sexual activity before you give the test or cycling can cause false elevations of your numbers. So we will typically try to work with you to isolate a lot of those variables and try to figure out if additional testing is needed based on your risk factors.
All right. We have been lucky enough to have some information given to us by the Spacer hydrogel, which is space OAR hydrogel. Tell me what that is and how it's used.
Right. So SpaceOAR is a really wonderful advance that's been made over the last several decades for patients who are undergoing treatment for prostate cancer, specifically radiation therapy. It's a way that we can help to minimize the effects of radiation on the other structures around the prostate gland. The prostate sits very close to some of the other structures like the rectum or the bowel. It sits right underneath the bladder. So through a very quick 5 to 10 minute procedure, and oftentimes we can put in a small needle and then put this gel that acts as a cushion and lifts up the prostate gland, keeping it away from some of the other structures. We found that it's safe, very quick and effective, and really helps patients to preserve their quality of life throughout treatment.
So it's, I don't want to be flippant, but it's a little bit like an insulation. It's a bubble wrap, if you will, just a gel to protect it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it basically is, like I said, a soft plane or a cushion. It's dissolved into water. It's typically natural and inert to the body and stays there for about 3 to 6 months before being absorbed. And then nothing you'll have to get removed here, but gives you the protection throughout your radiation therapy to make sure that, you know, the bowel and other structures are really not involved with that radiation.
That's so reassuring and really, really neat that it just dissolves and gets absorbed by the human body instead of having it be something that would then have to be removed in another treatment. What are some of the side effects from these treatments that this is helping to prevent?
So common side effects typically associated with radiation therapy historically have been things like rectal issues, meaning that because that rectum is very close to the prostate gland, with some of the older forms of radiation, we were delivering that beam and then having some effect on the rectal tissue. So it can cause things like loose bowels, an urgency to have to go to the bathroom, sometimes blood in the stool, or scar tissue in the bowel. Doing the SpaceOAR or the hydrogels has significantly reduced that risk in modern day, as well as some of the advances for how we tightly tailor that radiation to the prostate gland.
This is just fantastic. I love having these conversations because I get to learn. I mean, really, science is just so cool. And the fact that they have made things, it's like nobody wants to be told that they have cancer ever, but knowing that people are working on making these treatments as safe as possible and as comfortable as possible is really, really neat. Now, if someone is diagnosed with prostate cancer and they go through their treatments, what is the likelihood that they would have a recurrence potentially?
Yeah, so it will really depend on how aggressive their prostate cancer was at the onset. It will depend on their prostate cancer genetics, which we have tests to tell us. And it will also depend on how early we detect things. The earlier that we make these detections, the better the chance of cure rate is. And the majority of prostate cancers can be curative if detected early enough.
All right. How fast can a fast-moving prostate cancer develop?
Yeah. So some of the more aggressive prostate cancers can develop over the course of several weeks, so even several months.
Oh, God.
You know, many prostate cancers, particularly the lower risk kind, are ones that are slower growing and more indolent, meaning that if we identify a low risk prostate cancer, the genetics are of the low risk category, we may be able to watch those over time and not ever require a treatment. So that's also how we can use some of the information and testing to help guide our decisions together.
That is shocking because you think that going in and having your PSA checked every year should be sufficient. But as you mentioned, some of these can develop in weeks to months. We see this also in the breast cancer world where some of those, you know, they have a clear mammogram and 2 months later they're diagnosed because it developed after that. Are there other signs or symptoms that men should be paying attention to in case?
Right. So as we talked about, most prostate cancers are very silently growing within the prostate gland. So they would really only be able to be picked up with testing and ways that we can look non-invasively at some of those numbers. However, in some rare types of prostate cancer or sometimes prostate issues can arise with voiding problems, meaning that you are having frequent nighttime urination, having difficulty emptying your bladder, going to the bathroom too frequently, and more advanced advanced types of prostate cancer, you may get bony pain or pelvic pain, weight loss, fevers or chills, or loss of appetite.
But some of those symptoms, as you just mentioned, are normal things that men who are aging talk about.
Absolutely. So,
yeah, there's that weird, how do you know if something's wrong question.
Right. And so to your point there, that's where the testing and the screening tests that we have really shine, because they can open the door, pull back the curtain, and really show us if this is something that's normal for your aging process, or if this is something that we should look into a bit further.
All right. So really, the best advice is to have the yearly screenings, make sure that the PSA is a part of that, of your blood work, which I'm sure it would be if you are of a certain risk factor. So it is age and based on any other risk factors as well. And then pay attention to quick changes. If things change rapidly, then you need to communicate with your healthcare provider as well. And then they can send you to somebody amazing like Dr. Dean Laganosky out of Philadelphia, who is a urologist with MidLantic Urology. Let us go back again for those who are just joining us. We are talking about prostate cancer. There are other things, of course, that you work on, but this is one that I talk about quite frequently, because from, you know, somebody standing on the sidelines, this seems like an easy thing to do. What are the rates of people, of men, coming in and getting these tests? Are they, how many men are we missing? 50%, or we don't know?
We actually don't have great statistics on this. I mean, what we do know is that with some of the information that's being put out there, that men are starting to think about men's health a lot more, which is a really important thing for all people and all their different types of conditions we screen for. But the reality is that there are a majority of men who aren't really thinking about these things until later on in life. And I think the earlier that we have these conversations, the less stigma that's attached to these conversations, the more we'll be able to really make an impact and help people at an earlier stage. And these types of screening interventions and finding out things earlier can make a big difference in people's health.
As we also mentioned earlier, but it absolutely bears repeating, African-American men have a far more increased chance of being diagnosed with this. It is actually the second leading cause of cancer death in Black men is prostate cancer. So if you could review again those stats, just so we can, if anybody just joined us, they can learn this as well.
Absolutely. So the statistics would tell us that there is a 1.7-fold increase in the likelihood of having prostate cancer if you are an African-American male compared to other men in the population. And there's about a 2x risk of dying of prostate cancer compared to other men. So very, very important that we monitor and do the screening at appropriate intervals. And you meet with a healthcare provider who can help to work through some of these decisions with you.
Yeah. Movember has done an excellent job in talking more about men's health. And one of the things that they talk about is talking about this. So if you're listening to the program, please mention this to someone else that you care about or somewhere you're in the elevator with. You know, just say, hey, I heard this great. I'm just going to say it was great. This great interview on Beyond Sports. And because the more commonly talked about this is, the less stigma and embarrassment, and people will get themselves to a doctor more directly and more consistently, which is where you guys are going to make the biggest impact. We also, again, mentioned the spacer gel, hydrogel, which is just one of the coolest things that insulates the other areas from the prostate when it's being treated. I know that there are still invasive treatments, but a lot of that has been diminished based on some advances.
Absolutely. And we're constantly looking at ways that we can do things in a less invasive fashion and still get excellent treatment outcomes. So there's been a lot of progress on this over the recent decades. Some of the stories that you may hear about types of treatments years ago are just not even in the consideration at this point. So ways that we can help to contain cancer, treat cancer and cure it, but also preserve your quality of life throughout your treatment and beyond for many years after.
You mentioned earlier that there are 180,000 new cases of prostate cancer every year, which seems that's a tremendously large number. But in the whole of the Americas, that's not a ton. Are we seeing more cases or fewer cases?
Yeah, so very good question. And that statistic is just for the US alone. So Worldwide, that number is likely much higher. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you're right. I mean, are we detecting all of the patients who could be helped with screening? And the answer is definitively no at this point. And we really need to be focused more on making this a national conversation, a more common conversation. To your point earlier, speak to a friend, speak to a loved one if you have any concerns that they're not getting the appropriate screening. And if you're a man talking to another individual who's a man, you are likely to find that they are having some of the same types of thoughts about this as you are. So it's a very common and widespread thing. I think what we really need to focus on here is ways that we can get more individuals through the door to at least have the conversation. There's no obligation that you have to go down the next route, but we can give you all the tools to make the most informed decision about your health, and that is paramount.
Yeah, no one wants to be told they have cancer, but knowing it earlier is the best option you have. Another interview, a doctor said, doctors don't give you cancer. They merely tell you if you have it or not. And that's so important. Everyone, I understand I don't want to get a shot or have blood drawn, but it is so wonderful that we live in a time where a simple blood test can help us live longer. So that is what I recommend. Are there lifestyle changes at all that people can do to diminish their risk for prostate cancer?
Yeah, so we've looked at a lot of different types of supplements and dietary components in the literature, selenium, vitamin E, lycopene. None have really held fast in the clinical trials. However, I will say that a healthy prostate diet is a healthy heart diet, is a healthy lifestyle diet. So reducing red meat, reducing charred foods or complex carbohydrates, processed foods, those are the types of dietary changes that are going to make a big impact in every person's life and their longevity and their kind of overall health, not only from a urinary tract standpoint, but from a heart standpoint and kind of a diabetes or blood sugar control standpoint. So, trying your best to carve out a couple minutes a day to even do a little bit of exercise, get your body into a routine of doing some of these things in terms of healthy habits will go a long way.
And those can start long before you turn 50, which is the recommended age for other men, just the general population. It starts as early as 40 or 45 for African-American men. And then based on risk factors that are genetics, et cetera, those are going to be decided by you and your healthcare provider. Because as we've been mentioning over and over, it is a simple blood test. At one of the detections is a PSA test. Dr. Laganosky, a urologist out of Philadelphia, MidLantic Urology, part of the Solaris National Health Group. Any closing thoughts for us on how we can best treat and take care of ourselves?
I always say information is power. Information gives us the ability to help make informed decisions for you and about your health. And, we take it very seriously to have this be personalized and have this be tailored to you and your goals. So part of the evaluation here is meeting with someone who can help you to navigate what is going to be best for you and your health. Our goals are the same as yours, which is to provide a healthy life for you and your family members. So reach out, get screened, meet with a medical professional, and come up with a game plan as to how we can best help you and how we can move your healthcare forward.
Dr. Laganosky, thank you so much for your time and for teaching me and our listeners so much about prostate cancer and some of the treatments and really how to get screened, which is the most important portion, in my opinion.
Absolutely my pleasure, and thank you so much for the opportunity, Hannah.
Oh, you bet. Hannah Stanley, Beyond Sports. I will talk to you next week.